When it comes to 8-bit action platformers, the NES was filled with heavyweights like Chip and Dale, DuckTales, Mega Man, Castlevania, and even Ninja Gaiden. Then you have the ones that fall a bit short on the list like Kickmaster. Just look at the extension of the leg. I would seriously injure myself if I ever tried anything like that. Then there's Iron Sword that everyone and their grandmother had. It's not that it's a terrible game, it's just that everyone was sold on the cover with Fabio wielding that giant sword, hair blowing in the wind. Then we have today's game, Monster in My Pocket. This franchise is based off of the bite-sized toys that would come in a 4-pack that would, well, you guessed it, fit in your pocket. It's almost like the B-team of toys for kids whose parents didn't buy them G.I. Joes or Ninja Turtles. There was also this cartoon that only had one episode come to light as a pilot where these monsters are shrunk down and are somehow able to transform back to normal size. There's also some sort of mind control of a dog taking place. Yeah, I can't say it was any good, but yeah, at least it brought us the game by Konami, so it had that going for it. So what do you get when you mix a B-tier toy slash cartoon with an A-tier developer and publisher? You get yourself one heck of a decent game. Released in 1992 by Konami, Monster in My Pocket lets you choose between one of two incredibly generic names, The Vampire or The Monster. Oh, I'll just say it, why not? They're Dracula and frickin' Frankenstein. These tiny action figures then sit in front of a Konami branded TV and are greeted by this Christopher Mayer lookalike by the name of Warlock, who tells you that the henchmen are on the loose and laughs in your face. Dracula and Frankenstein, I mean, the monster and the vampire then run into action. The gameplay is straightforward for an NES game. You run around using the D-pad, press A to jump, or double tap A to double jump, or the B button to punch, but the punch button had obvious short range. It was almost like doing that tiny fireball in Street Fighter that does just the right amount of damage. There were also these keys or bolts you can grab and throw, but they really weren't found too often, so you'll have to rely on the tiny punch for each of the characters that you're stuck with. As you make your way throughout the 6 stages of the game, fighting monsters or avoiding obstacles, the levels are well laid out and colorful. Most in typical big world, small person areas. Here you're running down a staircase railing since you're a Honey I Shrunk the Kids sized toy. Or on the kitchen countertop. Watch out for that boiling pot. The bosses are nothing to write home about. Here we have the evil Ice Cube next to what appears to be an unbranded Ben & Jerry's Cherry Garcia. The final stage has a boss rush, where you'll have to fight all of the bosses again before the boss who flies around like an asshole and shoots lightning your way. The tracks were catchy at best. It wasn't Konami's best work on the musical side, but didn't bore me enough to turn off the game after a couple of stages. I mean, when the bar is set to Castlevania's Bloody Tears level of effort, I wouldn't consider the tracks anything to write home about. Did you also know that there were at least 20 unreleased figures, including 4 available by purchasing certain products like the NES video game, going to certain restaurants, sending in $5 for a grab bag offer, and even going to local radio and TV offers to obtain them? Konami did a great job in turning a toy series into a fun action platformer game. It's also got a co-op mode where you can grab a buddy and breeze through this game. The downfall of Monster in My Pocket is that it's incredibly easy. Once you get the hang of it, expect to finish it in less than half an hour. There's so many extra heart jars laying around that it's so hard to lose all of your health. There's also a ton of continues you get if you do manage to lose all of your lives. I'm the Retro Kingpin. Thanks for watching.